إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله فاللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا وللسامعين ولجميع المسلمين أجمعين. بسم الله. I ask Allah the Almighty to preserve us all and our families, and to cure us all and all the Muslims, and to uplift this pandemic from the Ummah. May Allah Azza wa Jal grant us all beneficial knowledge that we all act upon, and Allah accepts it from us all. Last week, we had the introduction of this book, Al-Usul al-Thalatha, the three fundamental principles of Islam. And with this lesson, we covered different stuff, and from them was the reason why this book is very important. And it is a must that we all learn and understand and implement. And of course, the reason for this book being important, and from the books that each and every Muslim should have in their households and understand it and read it and implement it and teach their children, friends and family, is that every single soul, كما قال الله عز وجل كل نفس ذائقة الموت, as Allah the Almighty mentions in the Quran, that every single soul shall taste death, every single soul. So of course, when one enters his grave, when his friends and families and his loved ones leave him, and he hears the footsteps of them leaving, two angels come to him, the deceased one in his grave, and they ask him the three questions of who is your Lord, Who is your Lord? What is your religion? And who is the man that came to you and that was sent to you? So of course, this is the reason why each and every one of us have to understand and read this book, that at this moment of time when one is in his grave, if one didn't implement the teachings of Allah Azza wa Jal, that which He has taught, that which He has ordered us to act out in terms of obeying Him and worship and staying away from that which He has prohibited, and of course, without a doubt, obeying the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, then one won't be able to answer these three questions, even if he knew who his Prophet was, what his religion was, and who his Lord was. If he didn't implement it and believe in it and understand it, then inside the grave he will not be able to do so. And without a doubt, whether one wants to see it now or not, it is going to be a difficult time for each and every one of us. As remember, brothers and sisters, when you're in your grave 6 foot under, no single soul shall be with you, next to you. The one that you loved, your wife, your mother, your father, your kids, your friends, those that you met in the worldly life, not a single one of them will be with you in your grave. They won't be able to help you. They won't be able to answer the three questions on your behalf. It's going to be a very, 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 very scary time and moment when two angels will come to you and you didn't live the life you were supposed to live, al-Islam, as a Muslim. You didn't live the life you were supposed to live by listening to Allah from that which He has commanded you to do so, from that which He had commanded you, and that which He has commanded you to stay away from and abstain, and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So you have to remember, in this world, you only have one chance, one shot to implement al-Islam. We should enter into Islam wholeheartedly and take that which Islam has told us and taught us. ادخلوا في السلم يا أيها الذين آمنوا ادخلوا في السلم كافة. Or you who believe, enter in Islam wholeheartedly. So it's not something that we should joke around with or think, oh, this is something lame to study such a book or to read such books. Oh, we always hear these books of Tawheed, Islamic monotheism. We always hear these words always being implemented, always being taught, and always on, you know, we always hear these books and it's always Tawheed. But of course, why is it so important to learn the correct aqidah, tawheed, Islamic monotheism. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he wasn't in Mecca. For the time or period that he was in Mecca, he wasn't there just for 1 year calling the people to tawheed, calling the people, اعبدوا الله ولا تشركوا به شيئا. He wasn't there for just 1 year or 2 years or 3 years or 4 years. He was there for 10 years before the other things he was told to teach the people, like salah. So for all these years, calling the people to tawheed, it shows you how important it is. And telling them to leave away worshipping Allah with partners. So this is why it is very important to study the likes of these books, Al-Usul al-Thalatha. Nabda ala barakatillah. So the Shaykh Muhammed bin Abdulwahab started his book with the Basmala, which is Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, or Bismillah. This is the Basmala. Now we all see this many times when we read Islamic books or the Quran, but we should know why. Why is it that the scholars of Islam, they start their books with this? And the core reason is because it is from the acts of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, may Allah have mercy on him, may peace and blessings be upon him, when he used to send his companions out to deliver a message to the great rulers like Hirqal and so many other rulers of his times, when he would send them to send a message, he would start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So this is one of the reasons why the scholars do so, because it is a sunnah from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But before all of this, we all know without a doubt that Allah Azza wa Jal, the Almighty, started his book, his noble book, Al-Quran, with the Basmala. So this is the reason why the Shaykh, Shaykh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, may Allah have mercy on his soul, started his book with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So it should also be a thing that we also take into action to do. As for the word Allah, then it is derived from the word Al-Ilah, which literally means Al-Ilah, God, who is Al-Ma'bud, which means the one that deserves to be worshipped. So once again, the word Allah is derived from the word in the Arabic language, Al-Ilah, which literally means God, who of course is Al-Ma'bud. Al-Ilah ay Al-Ma'bud, which means the one that deserves to be worshipped. And to expand on this a little bit, there are many false deities that people have taken as gods, but Allah Azza wa Jal, the Almighty, is the one that deserves to be worshipped alone in truth. And the word Allah is specifically for Allah only, and no being is named Allah except Him, Allah the Almighty. So it is not a name one of the humans, one of us, can take or give our children the name of Allah, because this name is solely for Allah Azza wa Jal, the Almighty, as He is the sole creator of all that exists in this universe, and the provider, and He is the sustainer for all of the creation. Which is what Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu mentioned, as he said that Allah is the sole creator who has no partners, and that He is the only one deserving to be worshipped, who deserves to be worshipped alone. As for Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, then these are two names which affirm, Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim are two names that affirm the attribute. It affirms the attribute of mercy. So as Muslims, we believe, walillahi alhamd, that Allah has names and He has attributes. Allah has many names and He has many attributes. That which is mentioned in the Quran and in the Sunnah, we believe that the names and attributes that were mentioned in the Quran and in the Sunnah as they are, and we do not, as the misguided sects, many of them, they negate many of the names and attributes, and so on and so forth. As for the meaning of Ar-Rahman, then it shows that Allah's mercy Of course, without doubt, Allah is merciful. We know this. This is one of the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jalla, that He is merciful. So the name Ar-Rahman, it shows that Allah's mercy is vast. As for this name, then it should only be for Allah Azza wa Jalla. So as for Ar-Rahman, then it shows that Allah's mercy is vast, and this name Ar-Rahman, it should only be for Allah Azza wa Jal. As for Ar-Rahim, then it shows that the mercy of Allah, the Almighty, reaches His slaves. So the difference between the two, Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim, is that Ar-Rahman, it shows that Allah's mercy is vast. As for Ar-Rahim, then it shows that the mercy of Allah, the Almighty, reaches His slaves. So, and this name, i.e. Ar-Rahim, this name can be named to other than Allah Azza wa Jal. Al-Usul al-Thalatha, brothers and sisters, splits into three different types of categories, meaning within this book, there are three different types of categories. The first part, which inshallah we'll see, تعلم أربع مسائل, i.e. to learn the four principles. This first part points towards al-usul al-thalatha. As for the second part, which is أن الله لم يخلقنا هملا, that Allah the Almighty didn't create us for no reason or for not a purpose, then this part includes within it the love and hatred of Allah the Almighty that each and every Muslim should have. Al-wala wal-bara. And this is something that is very important for all of us Muslims to understand and be aware of, that as Muslims, if Allah Azza wa Jal loves something, then us Muslims or the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, then we should love it as well, because Allah and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam loved it. If Allah hates something and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam hates something, then us Muslims, we should also hate that thing. Why? Because Allah and the Messenger hates it. As for the third part of this book, when it mentions إِعْلَمْ أَرْشَدَكَ اللَّهِ, know may Allah guide you to the right path, then this part includes the correct creed and the sound belief and the Islamic monotheism of our Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, Prophet Abraham. So after the Basmala, the Shaykh began with إِعْلَمْ رَحِمَكَ اللَّهِ. The Shaykh began with إِعْلَمْ رَحِمَكَ اللَّهِ, which means know, may Allah have mercy on you. And many scholars of the past and the present start and include this within their books. Now the meaning of this is that the author, the Shaykh, wants to draw your attention as the reader of the book by him mentioning no, i'lam. It is an indication for you, the reader, to be attentive and pay attention to what is going to come next. But at the same time, and it's from the mercy of the great scholar and the scholars that mention these types of phrases within their books, it shows that they are merciful and they care about the one that's going to read their book. Because it says, Rahimakallah, may Allah have mercy on you. So at the same time, when the Shaykh is saying to you, pay attention, may Allah have mercy on you, he's making dua for you, the reader, reading the book. And that shows the mercy of this great scholar. And then the Shaykh goes on to mention, he says, إِعْلَمْ رَحِمَكَ اللَّهُ أَنَّهُ يَجِبُ عَلَيْنَا تَعَلُّمَ إِعْلَمْ رَحِمَكَ اللَّهُ أَنَّهُ يَجِبُ عَلَيْنَا تَعَلُّمُ أَرْبَعِ مَسَائِلِ. He said, it is imperative. يَجِبُ عَلَيْنَا تَعَلُّمُ أَرْبَعِ مَسَائِلِ. It is imperative for us to learn four principles. So we should all know that by just reading this, it shows us firstly how much this great man, this scholar, cared for the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to even author a book like this book. And secondly, it shows us that he was a merciful scholar for him to actually make dua for the reader by him mentioning a number, saying four principles. He didn't just say, يَجِبُ عَلَيْنَا تَعَلُّمُ مَسَائِلِ. He mentioned arba' masail, meaning four principles. So this makes it easy for us reading this book in this particular part to know that there's three principles that he's about to mention, and to keep note that the principles are four. And this was something, without a doubt, our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do with his companions. When he would mention something that was important or of great matter, he would mention to them the number, and then they would know what was going to come next. So just in case someone wanted to memorize or to keep note, he would know that there are four principles, or three or five. Now, the first principle from the four, and I strongly recommend everyone listening, if they have the book in front of them, to kind of keep note. May Allah accept it from us all. So the first principle of the four is al-ilm, knowledge. And of course, here what is meant by knowledge is the Islamic knowledge. And the Islamic knowledge splits into two categories. The first type is the mandatory knowledge, i.e. the one that is wajib. It is mandatory for each and every Muslim, those that have reached the age of puberty, to seek, which is called fard ain. The second type is the type that is not mandatory on each and every single Muslim, i.e. if a group of Muslims seek and learn it, then it uplifts this obligation on the rest of the ummah, which is called fard kifaya. So the first type is fard ain. Fard ain, i.e. the knowledge that is mandatory on each and every single Muslim, male, female, that have reached the age of puberty, have to learn, which is called fard ain. And inshallah, we'll discuss the reason why each and every Muslim have to learn this type of knowledge. As for the second type, is fard kifaya. And that type is the type that if a group of Muslims seek and learn this knowledge, then it uplifts this obligation on the rest of the Muslims, which is called fard al-kifaya. So fard kifaya, for example, we'll start with fard kifaya, the one that is not mandatory upon every Muslim. Learning inheritance, al-fara'id. Learning inheritance is not mandatory upon every single Muslim, even if they've reached the age of puberty. So this falls under the second type of knowledge. Why? Because it's not mandatory for each and every Muslim to know inheritance. Now, if you compare learning inheritance to something like as-salah, or learning wudu, or zakah, then as-salah, wudu, and zakah falls under which category? Of course, it falls under the first category, which is fard ain. The reason being is, if a person doesn't know how to make wudu, then he cannot pray. And praying is from the wajibat. It is from the arkan, from the pillars of al-Islam. So learning how to make wudu, learning how to pray, it is fard ain. Learning how to give zakah, it is something which is fard ain. And there's a principle here which I want everyone to bear in mind and jot down. It's very, very important in our religion. مَا لَا يَقِيمُ الدِّينُ إِلَّا بِهِ فَهُوَ وَاجِبُ مَا لَا يَقِيمُ الدِّينُ إِلَّا بِهِ فَهُوَ وَاجِبُ It's a very nice principle. If the religion cannot be completed without it, then it is mandatory. This is the principle. If the religion cannot be completed without it, then it is wajib. So for example, al-wudu. If one does not know how to make wudu, he cannot pray. If one doesn't pray, then without a doubt, he is not fulfilling one of the pillars of al-Islam, which is as-salah. So then the Shaykh mentions al-ilm. So we've mentioned that ilm splits into two categories. What is ilm? Here the Shaykh said, al-ilm, وَهُوَ مَعْرِفَةُ اللَّهِ وَمَعْرِفَةُ نَبِيِّهِ وَمَعْرِفَةُ دِينُ الْإِسْلَامِ بِالْأَدِلَّةِ Knowledge, which is the knowledge of Allah, and knowing Allah, His Messenger, al-Islam, with proof. So which means that this knowledge has to be based upon Quran and Sunnah. And the knowledge, there is no knowledge more beneficial than the knowledge of your creator, Allah Azza wa Jal, the one who created the whole universe. And this is from the most important types of knowledge, seeking knowledge of our Lord, Allah Jalla Jalalu, the Almighty. So knowledge is knowing Allah, knowing His Messenger, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who was sent down to all of mankind, which was not like the other prophets. They were sent to their people or their specific time when they were sent down, they were sent to a group of people. But as for the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he was sent down to the whole of mankind, the humans and the jinns. So even the jinns, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was sent to them. And knowing Al-Islam, the religion of Al-Islam. So which means that this knowledge has to be based upon Quran and Sunnah. The knowledge has to be based upon Quran and Sunnah. قال الشيخ إسلام بن تيمية رحمه الله من فارق الدليل ضل السبيل وما دليل إلا ما جاء به الرسول. Shaykh Sami ibn Taymiyyah mentions, whoever abandons the proof will be misguided from the path, and there is no proof except that which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. Allahu Akbar. This here should be written in gold, the statement of Shaykh Sami ibn Taymiyyah, may Allah have mercy on him. Whoever abandons the proof, and many people nowadays, sadly, they make their intellect precede Al-Islam and the religion. So they abandon the proof, even though in the Quran it mentions a specific matter. They use their own intellect and the time and day and age they live in, and they leave off the proof. So Shaykh Sami ibn Taymiyyah is saying, whoever abandons the proof will be misguided from the path, and there is no proof except that which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. And you have another type of people where they accept the proof, but their proof is taken from sources that are weak. And alhamdulillah, our deen is complete, brothers and sisters. اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. Our deen was completed 1400 years ago when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came and was sent, and when he completed the risala, as that which he did, the deen was completed. So we do not need to bring other proofs from other sources that are not authentic. Because if one does that, then he'll be following his desires, and he'll be misguided in his own path. And the correct proof is the proof that what the Prophet ﷺ came with. Because وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. Literally, it is the Prophet ﷺ does not utter from his own desires or that which he pleases with, but rather it is a revelation being revealed to him from Allah Azza wa Jalla, the Almighty. And Allah Azza wa Jalla mentions in the Quran, وَإِنَّهُ لَتَنْزِيلُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. And surely this Quran is a revelation from the Lord of mankind. The religion of Allah is not that which pleases our souls or our personal life, but rather it is that which was revealed to our beloved Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, from Allah to Jibreel alayhi salam to the Prophet sallam. This is what the deen is built upon. Two main authentic sources, Quran and Sunnah. It is built upon proof. That is why we should all seek knowledge and strive in doing so. Knowledge of Al-Islam is not based upon intellect. It is qala Allah, qala Rasul, ala fahmi sahaba ridwanullahi alayhim wa salaf radiyallahu anhum. Just like the Prophet ﷺ mentions in the hadith, خَيْرُ النَّاسِ قَرُنِي ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ. It's very simple. خَيْرُ النَّاسِ قَرُنِي ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ. The best of people is my generation and those that come after them and those that come after them, i.e. the three generations, 300 years. Those were the Salaf al-Salih. And that is how we should take our religion. Not just on something that we think is correct, or we ourselves. You hear many people today, they make their own ijtihad. How can you base upon that which you think is correct to the religion? It is sad. For us, many times we see, sadly, in this day and age, because we have been exposed to that which we've been exposed to, we go and study and we graduate from universities, seeking knowledge, but not Islamic knowledge. And because we've reached somewhere in our lives where we think we're well-spoken or we're intellectual people, we first put our intellect first and use philosophy, psychology, that which, whatever you want to name it, al-mutakallimun, many, whatever you want to name it, you use that which you think is correct in your own belief and you put it in front of the actual religion. And this is something that Allah al-Musta'an should not be done, because the deen should go first and then we should take next our own personal lives. But the deen should always come first in our lives. So knowing Allah Azza wa Jal, how many of us say we know Allah? Many of us say we love Allah, I love my Lord, I love Allah, I fear Allah. But yet our actions say otherwise. So if you love Allah Azza wa Jal, it should show within your actions, within your speech. Not just your actions, but your speech as well. You say good things. مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيَقُلْ خَيْرًا أَوْ لِيَصْمُتْ. Whoever believes Allah in the last day should say something good, or he should keep quiet. We should show that we love Allah by obeying him and his messenger. And to know that he is the sole one that deserves to be worshipped alone in truth. And all of the other false deities are not deserving of being worshipped. But remember, brothers and sisters, the only way we can know Allah the Almighty and increase our knowledge about him is by seeking knowledge. And this is from the least we should do, as he is the Almighty who has blessed us with our health, wealth, family, friends, and so many other things. As Allah says in the Quran, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. It's impossible. And if you would count the graces of Allah, never could you be able to count them. He is the one that took you from that which you were from, that which you were in, al-dhulumat. You were misguidance and darkness. And he led you and guided you to light and nur. And the other one, the Shaykh mentions, ma'rifatul rasul, to know the messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ibn Abdullah. And knowing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his slave and messenger. And this, of course, without a doubt, would lead one to success. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us the religion and how to worship Allah correctly. And we'll stop here, bi-idhnillah ta'ala. And inshallah, next week we'll carry on. إذا متعنا الله بالحياة If anyone has any questions, if not, بإذن الله تعالى we'll conclude. Does anyone have any questions? سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت.
There's a question in the chat.
Does the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم get asked the three questions? الله أعلم. Allah knows best. العلم قبل القول والعمل. This is something, inshallah, I'll do research and I'll touch upon next week, بإذن الله. To what extent should the intellect be used? Well, akhi, in terms of the religion, akhi al-kareem, then without a doubt, nothing should precede the adillah, Quran and Sunnah, with your intellect. It doesn't matter how much, and this is what the scholars always mention, it doesn't matter how much you may be in a situation where you think you know something. Even if you know something, you should never use your intellect with regards to the religion, especially if it goes against the religion. This is what we're talking about, something that goes against the religion. So just an example, Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, he was known to be a very, very strong memory. But even despite the fact that he had a strong memory, whenever he would go to his lessons, he would have his book and read from his books, even though he had memorized that which he is teaching. So this is just an example in terms of him using his own knowledge to teach something, but rather he's using the sources that he has in front of him and using his books. But in terms of intellect, then of course, without a doubt, akhi, one shouldn't use his intellect to go against the religion of Islam. So the Islam, meaning the Quran and Sunnah, the proof from the Quran and Sunnah should always be first and precede the intellect. The book is Al-Usul al-Thalatha, the three fundamental principles. And you can find it online, the three fundamental principles by Shaykh Muhammed Ibn Abdulwahab. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اشهد ان لا اله الا انت استغفرك واتوب اليك هذا وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين اللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا ولجميع المسلمين اجمعين وصلى الله عز وجل يتقبل منا صالح الاعمال والسلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته